I'm gonna bring up Matt Reagan and Ryan Daly from Operation 36. We've recently partnered with these guys to help them grow their business, and I think you're gonna be interested in what you hear around group coaching, growing instruction revenue, and some of the pretty interesting numbers that they have associated with that. So appreciate you guys being here, and hand it over to Ryan.
And you can ask them some questions as well. But thank you for your time. Matt and I are extremely humbled to be here to speak to you about what we absolutely love to do, which is create golfers. And that's what we do. I know the volume wasn't phenomenal on that video, but what we do is we create golfers by putting them in long-term programs and getting them to shoot even par or better for 9 holes. Does that make sense? Pretty simple concept.
In the better? In the back? Okay.
Awesome. If you can for me, I always like to do this to get people engaged. If you have a journal or you have something to write on, if you get that out for me, and a pen. Just going to have you jot down some things today while we chat for a few minutes. And on your piece of paper, if you'll divide it in half, like I've got on the right side of my piece of paper, a vertical line down the middle, and the top left, if you'll write, made sense. And in the top right, a question mark. If you don't have a piece of paper, if you need to use your phone, that's perfectly fine. If you need to borrow a pen, that's perfectly fine too. So in the top left, you're writing down made sense. So something that we say this morning that makes sense to you. And then in the top right, maybe a question mark, something that you have a question for us at the end. Now the neat thing about watching that video at the beginning is Matt and I started back in 2009, and we've had some colossal failures in trying to get this off the ground. And we're going to share some of those with you today to hopefully help you at your club, and you have maybe get one nugget, at least one nugget from us that'll help you at your club and creating golfers at your programs.
Okay, so to lead us off, as Ryan mentioned, we've been on this journey for 8 years as coaches, and we look back and we say, well, how do we actually grow the game? Well, we have to do that by creating golfers, but not also creating golfers, but retaining golfers and getting them to play for a lifetime. But one thing that we notice along this journey is it's we're hired as independent contractors, our company, iGrowGolf, to come and run family coaching programs. When we started, we said, you know, what if we could financially support someone in a facility that their whole job and their whole goal was just to create new golfers at the facility and retain the golfers, make sure they're playing and make sure they're staying in the game. And so what we found is there's three categories: coaching impact, student impact, and facility impact that we need to be able to measure to make sure there's a healthy relationship and see how coaching programs can drive the activity to create new golfers and activity at the club. Well, Joe Alden, who's here today, a year ago, he was at McGregor Downs Golf Club as the head professional, a year and 6 months ago, and we approached him and said, Joe, we know your guy just left, who was the director of instruction here. We wanted to, would you mind if we paid you to work here to run just juniors? And so Joe kind of heard us out and took a chance on Ryan and I, and we wanted to test this. We've never been able to test it at private facilities. We started at public facilities in the middle of nowhere. So if we did, I don't know, does anyone know where Boys Creek, North Carolina is? If you've been there, it's the middle of nowhere. It's like the median household income of $31,000. And we had 60 juniors coming once a week for 32 weeks a year. But what we found are these are the metrics that we like to be able to measure. And the Op36 platform measures these metrics to make sure that you're seeing the healthy ecosystem at your club. And these are what we found. This is 2016. We were there for only 1 year and 6 months. Kind of the basic structure, the juniors enroll come once a week for 32 weeks a year. March, April, May, June, we take July off, go August, September, October, November. So they know it's a long-term program. These are what we found as far as our metrics. For our coaching impact, we pulled in $83,000 in revenue. This is 2016 numbers. Average hourly rate of $216 an hour, that's what 77 juniors enrolled. And we work about 12 hours a week. It's just after school programs. And the neat thing about that is yes, as a coach, it doesn't sound like a lot of time that we're putting in, but we always have put ourselves in the assistant professional shoes and the head professional shoes that are working 60 hours a week. How do we maybe pull them out and be able to get them into plugged into a program? And we feel like 12 hours a week is a pretty easy way to do that. The biggest impact that we found that you're gonna see today is strokes lost. How many strokes the person was losing, and actually proving that they're getting better at the game is what drives all of this. It was the one thing that we didn't really get, and Ryan's gonna go over, but the main, and then what we started noticing is, you know, we could see the increase in activity at the facility. We were never able to measure it, but the general manager at McGregor Downs said, here's what we'll do. We'll measure the students and families who weren't enrolled in your program in 2014 to what they are now in 2016. And here's what we found is a facility impact. So if we have 77 juniors coming once a week for 32 weeks a year, a minimum of once a week, that's a minimum of that many visits, but we never could measure if it was actually having a facility impact. What we found is there was a 21% increase overall at the entire facility for those families who were enrolled in the coaching program. So yes, their juniors were spending about $1,200 on average to be in the program, but we were creating significantly more value and getting them to the club than other sports programs in the area. So today we're gonna, to kind of go into the next phase, we launched last year for 2016, and we started and said, we're gonna train. We had so many professionals asking us, can we use this? So we launched in 2016, our first licensing, put together a training program for everyone to use it, and we're getting similar results at other facilities, which is really neat. Some of them are actually crushing our numbers out of the water, and we're learning from them. And we're in USA and Canada, and launch in the UK in March 2017.
Okay. Is that the, awesome. Just to give you a little bit about us and how we started, we had no intention to be at 68 facilities across the United States and Canada and launching international. When we started this, I was working at Campbell University and Matt was a student. It was a concept that we came up with. My son on the left was born a year before, and my wife and I said, we really want him to grow up at a golf course. We thought it was a great place for him to go up and get mentors and problem solve and have some great people out at the golf course. But the challenge, as Matt said, we're in the middle of North Carolina, Keith Hills Golf Club, with no kids. There was no money, and the population there was 2,000 people, which is mostly college students. So I turned to Matt, who was in my office all the time, and I said, Matt, you want to start a junior golf program? And he said, here? You want to do it here? I said, yeah, if we can get it to work here, we can get it to work anywhere. So that's kind of our backstory on how we got to today. And please, we had no intention of sharing everything we had when we first started, and we'll go into... some of our experiments that didn't work. We were actually embarrassed when people would start reaching out to us on Facebook and Twitter and say, this is an awesome program we have going on, will you share it with us? The problem was we weren't effective. In the first 3 years, we lost 50% of the kids that we had. We didn't make any money, and the kids didn't get any better. So we're here to share with you today our top three lessons that we think would be helpful for you to know at your facility so you don't make the same mistake we did. Is that okay if we share that with you today? Yeah, okay.
So the three areas that we learned was we needed to measure fun, measure play, and measure marketing. Those were the three areas to really get something like this up and going, and up and going fast. The first one we're going to cover is measuring fun. And we're going to kind of try to fly through these. We could take a while and explain in depth, but we're going to try to fly through these because we have three people who have used the program that are members, and we just want you to hear from them on the impact they have for the last year. But when we first started, all we did was focus. We said, hey, now we have to have 32 weeks of curriculum, at least, to be able to run this. What the heck do we do? And what was in the industry before was just, hey, let's just make it fun. Because that's what we kept saying. The number one thing, it needs to be fun. So we played a lot of games, and we put some blow-up Godzillas on the driving range, and we used the snag clubs, and we, you know, threw water balloons. We did all of it. I mean, we were, and it, there was, what we found first is there was a lack of structure. So we found TPI's long-term athletic development plan. We went out, got trained, put in the 10 hat levels, was measuring fitness, measuring a ton of different areas. And this is Claire here on the right. This is Claire leveling up, and you can see we had little booklets and kind of a structure in place. But we had these 10 hat levels, and we're like, man, that's really tough to manage 10 hat levels. What do? Move them up in different classes? How do you manage this curriculum that you're starting to put in? And how do you make sure that they actually are tracking and getting better? And what we ended up finding, we ended up kind of breaking that stuff down into six levels, what we came up with. And we had six different bag tags. And what that's evolved into now is, this is our updated bag tag. It's got 12 subjects on the back. And when the juniors can demonstrate an objective to us that's in that new mobile app that you saw in the video, the objectives are all in there, and that's the curriculum the coach teaches every week. When they demonstrate it to it, we put a little sticker on the back of their bag tag, and then once they earn all 12, they rank up, they go up to the next level. And we thought this, just that component, the back of the bag tag, and being able to show that measuring progress, that was the first step. That kept Claire in the program for 3 years. Ryan's going to share on play in just a second the piece that we were missing, but that only kept her in for 3 years. Claire's no longer in the program. She no longer plays golf. But this kind of foundation and the structure, and I'm going to share kind of just real quick the basics of that structure, is when you want to measure fun, it's not blow up Godzillas, it's not this. That's a one-time experience. It's going to keep them in the game just enough to keep them interested, but at some point, we have to make sure that we set the purpose for golf. So challenge point is something, we started studying long-term happiness because we thought about long-term fun. And long-term happiness, we found this book called by Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi, it's a tough one to pronounce. And he studied this concept called flow and happiness. What makes people happy for the long term? And what he found is it's really a pursuit of a task or challenge that's just above our ability. So those are what those badges came from. It was, how do we find a player's skill level? And we match it up with a challenge that's similar to their skill level. And so if we look down here, the task or challenge, it's easy or hard. And you can see there's this line. If we set this, like for example, if we set a 10 attempts to make 1 5-foot putt, is that an easy task or a hard task? pretty easy. So if we had a beginner player, you know what? That matches up with the beginner player skill level pretty easily, all right? So they're pretty happy. Man, I did it, I accomplished it, right? But then you have someone in your program in a group coaching, and they're a little bit more experienced. What is that player? If you give them that same task, they're bored, right? Too easy. So that's what a lot of what the program was, is we wanted to make sure that after one objective was complete, there's another one set, and there's another one set. It doesn't stop. You always keep continuing a challenge. On the other side of that spectrum, if we gave 10 attempts to make 10 5-foot putts, that's a little bit more challenging. That might match up with the challenge point for the more advanced player, but it doesn't match up for the beginner player, right? And now they're over-challenged, they're anxious, they're frustrated, they leave the game. How about when we take a complete beginner and we put them on the back, on the even the level one forward tees, and they end up shooting a 70, and it takes them five hours to play 9 holes? That's this person. How do you think that experience is? They're leaving the game. They're not coming back. How, my goodness, it takes 5 hours to play? That took forever. It sucked. I sucked. So we wanted to figure out, how do we lower that challenge point to here to be able to build them up and make them feel like they're good from the get-go? But how do you do that on a mass scale? It's really challenging, and that's why it's taken us 8 years. But the main piece that we want to get out of this measuring fun, remember, fun isn't just blow up Godzilla. If we want to keep them involved for the whole time, we have to find how we find a player's ability or challenge point. And it's up to us as golf professionals to set a challenge for each of our students or each of our players at the club. Give them something that they're working towards. Raise the challenge just a little bit, and that's where growth and learning occurs, and that's what's fun. It's like when we're taking a new job at a new club. We are excited, right? We have a new purpose. We're moving up. We're progressing. That's what they want in the golf industry. That's what they want to be. That's what our game does that teaches them. And when you do that, that's when they grow. When they see success and they grow, that's valuable, and they pay for that. And that's our importance on measuring fun. I'm going to turn over to Ryan and how he shares how we measure play.
Thank you, Matt. All right, 3 years in, Claire turns to me, and I ask her in class, I'll always remember this moment, 2013. She turns to me, I say, Claire, you love coming to the golf course. Your parents have paid us $1,500 a year for 3 years, almost $5,000. You love coming to the golf course. Have you played golf? But, and she turned to me and she said, no, I haven't been on the golf course. I said, you've been with us for 3 years and you paid us almost $5,000 and you have not been on the golf course. The challenge that Matt and I had, we went to the pro shop, we put our head in our hands and we said, what are we doing? What are we doing as golf professionals if we're running these programs, asking parents to pay us money for them to come every week for 8 months out of the year, and she has a phenomenal time doing cartwheels. She has a phenomenal time throwing a football left-handed and right-handed and hitting a tennis racket, but we can't get her on the course. We can't get her to love the game. And that's where we said we gotta try something different. Our playing component at that time, which may be similar to your facilities, is once a month we would take them on the golf course. I'll set the stage for you. There's two coaches. There's 12 students and 2 golf carts. So in a 90-minute class, we got in maybe 2 holes on the golf course, playing every format that we could think of to keep it fun. But at no point did they actually play the game and write down a score. So they still weren't engaged in the sport. We felt like we were motivators with, you know, pom-poms and getting them all excited each week, but they actually weren't engaged in the sport. So we kept doing that for a while, and then we got a hold of US Kids and we said, you know what, you have an awesome idea. Carry-based tee boxes. So Matt and I got our 2 TrackMans out, we said we were gonna measure every single kid and we're gonna figure out what tee box they should play from. And then we ran a tournament, because they still wouldn't come out to the golf course and play on a consistent basis, so we had to run an event. And after a 4-hour 9-hole event of us pulling our hair out and looking at scorecards that had 65 and 70 on it for 9 holes, that was not the solution that we were looking for. But we didn't know any better, so we kept doing that over and over again to try to get them on the golf course. It wasn't until we got to our current format that the video went over, which is where they play from the different yardages on the course, where they wanted to come to the golf course. Does anybody have an idea as to why maybe if they play from 25 yards away, They write down a score, why they would want to come to the golf course more often. Yes, Joe said they're writing good scores down that they're proud of, right? They're writing down threes and fours and fives instead of nines and tens. I'll always remember my son when he went out for the first time from 25 yards away. He was 5 years old. I said, you're playing in this. You're going to do this. And the max score at the time was an 8. He started out 8, 8, 8, 8, 4, 8, 8, 8, 8. And what did he talk about on the ride home? His 4. And he was addicted. He could not wait to get back the next weekend. He comes to 10 out of 12 classes we run a week, and he plays every Saturday and Sunday. He's addicted to the game of golf. And I truly believe that the only way to get engaged in the sport, like fully engaged in the sport, is to write down a score on the golf course. Many of you in here may disagree with me, and that's okay. But I truly believe to get fully engaged in the sport, we have to write down a score at some point. I get a couple nods.
Yep.
What this did is it allowed us to bring a group of golfers out to the course on a consistent basis. We had 30 kids playing every Saturday, and because the kids were putting good scores down, their parents and grandparents wanted to come and watch. So before long, we had 90 people coming on Saturday night and Sunday night to Keith Hills Golf Club in the middle of nowhere in North Carolina. Did the GM like us? He absolutely loved us. Golf cart sales every single time. The parents and grandparents want to take a cart, food and beverage, and greens fees. He absolutely loved us, and a lot of the metrics that Matt went over. I'm going to breeze through this real quick because the panel does a really good job on this, but strokes lost, Matt already talked about. We can compute that now. So back in 2015, I can see that the average student lost 11.7 strokes. Our facility lost almost 600 strokes. And when Jackson Holland's dad came to me and said, is Jackson getting better? I had an answer. Has anybody in this room, as golf professionals, and I have, has anybody in this room had a parent come up and say, is my child getting better? Yes, all of us are nodding. I've gotten that question so many times, and we had to answer with, they could do more push-ups, they could jump higher, but now we can say, Jackson lost 33 strokes this year. So that was a powerful metric. We can now compute perseverance awards, kids that have tried a yardage more than 20 times and still passed. And it makes the classes more valuable because the kids now know, I can't beat 36 from 50, I need to listen to my coach. So just, that's a wrap up of the playing aspect and how we got to playing. I hope that makes sense on the playing aspect.
And the final area that we wanted to share is Ryan and I would just sit down after these classes, is how important marketing was. We were so bad at communicating what we were doing, and a lot of it was because we didn't have anything when we first started, and if there was anything constant in our program, it was change, because we would run the class, get done, go, well, that sucked, and we need to change for next week, and we would change, and we would change, and we would change, and, we'd change, and this would continue. So our poor kids in our program always joke, like, I was in the hat system, and then I was in the 10-level bag tag system, and I was in the 6-level bag tag system, and now it's 2 bag tags, and now there's a mobile app, and now they've been through the whole gamut, unfortunately. So, but marketing and being able to communicate, we found is really important. So when we first started, it took us 2 hours to run parent orientations to explain what we did in the program and to try to prove ourselves and what we're going to run to get them to buy in to join us for 32 weeks. We've got it down to that 2-minute video now, which isn't great, but at least it explains our purpose. Our purpose with Operation 36, if someone said, what's the Op 36 program? It's a program designed to get your junior to shoot par better for 9 holes. And then they kind of look at you and you sit there and you're like, usually that, well, what's that score? It's usually 36 generally. And then you shut up. Well, how do you do that? Well, we have these matches we put them in. You can come out and caddy for them. And then we have academy classes every week for the entire golf season where they're going to work through a 6-level curriculum. And that curriculum has 12 subjects that we're going to deliver. And your junior's going to have to demonstrate 72 objectives to our coaches to be able to pass the entire program. Well, what's next? Well, if he passes the entire program, we have an elite development program that's gonna be able to transition them and maybe get them even farther in the sport if you want. So now we have this like long-term roadmap. It only takes that long to explain. It took us 8 years to get there. It didn't sound like that, But the main thing is, now that it sounds that, they're looking for programs like this. They're looking for consistency to plug them in because they want to know every Monday, Johnny's doing this, this, and this. And then once that happens, they're going to evaluate other programs that are out there. And I have a 1-month-old. It's my first baby, so I'm starting to realize kind of the push and drive that Ryan had when TR was born 8 years ago. But we went around and we explored daycares here recently. And it's another mortgage payment. It's unbelievable how expensive it is, but we're going to pay it. But we went to 3 different areas. And guess what? It was unbelievable to kind of like sit back. I had the one came in, they had a complete program and a folder put together for us. And I'm like, wow, this is unbelievable. And they showed us their curriculum, it's on the wall. And then I went to another one and they didn't have any of that. They just kind of showed us around, right? Then I went to another one, it was kind of similar. I'm like, well, without a price or anything, I'm going with this one. And that one happened to be priced a little bit cheaper than all of them. Heck yeah, man. But it was priced good, but that's the one we chose. So we need to be better than other sports programs, gymnastics, karate. We're competing with them. All those other after-school programs, we have to look better. And guess what? The beauty of golf is there's no other program. I had a dad tell me there, you think you're just running a junior program. I said, well, what do you mean? He's having a beer, watching his kids go through a thing. He goes, you give me an excuse to pull Jack out here every Saturday and Sunday and play golf. He's pulling me out here where I used to have to sit at 4 hours in a swim meet, and now I get to drink beer on Saturday and Sunday at the club and play golf with my kid. It's unbelievable. And then what we're evolving into now is we realize, man, this is how everyone should learn to play the game. And so that's why we evolved from last year to this year, we evolved that into a family coaching program. It works for ladies. We've piloted it with men, it works for men. Men, you gotta be like, it's all about the score, right? Who can shoot the lowest from Division I? We got, you know, Jack, you shot 21. But it's all about how you communicate and market everything, how excited you are. And that's why we think it's important that you have someone who's in your shop, someone who's there, who's what we call like the developer. Get those people active, and that's gonna generate a lot more revenue in all aspects of the game of golf, and that's how we grow it. Main purchase, the post-purchase decision is what we figured out is a really big driver. You can't just say you have a program, you have to back it up. You want those kids dragging you in, right? Man, Johnny loves this. And then the mobile app and everything we put together is to help prove your value as a professional. But the worst thing it does is it holds you accountable, right? If the kids aren't getting better, it showcases it. They're not having fun, they're not logging action, it showcases it. Final piece that I'll go on and we'll bring up the panel is just looking at your programs as lifetime customer value. And usually we have to explain this to teaching professionals. Everyone in here probably gets this, but you know, if we can look at our retention rate, we look at it just from a coaching program. If we know that we have a 91% retention rate, we know 9 times out of 10, they're gonna be coming back to our program. So when I close up in November and before we kick off our March semester, that's what our retention rate is. And I know if I had 100 students, 90 out of those 100 are coming back and they're paying me $1,200 a year, that can support me full-time as a coach at the facility. If we look and we build our programs for the long term and we look at every customer in the long term, that would be $12,000 in coaching revenue. We're not talking the other stuff that they're gonna be spending money on, but that's coaching revenue. But if they're at the course and they're in your program, they're gonna create revenue across the entire facility. And then, how much would you pay or invest on the front end to be able to get a student that's going to become a 10-year lifespan member at your facility? And we invest our time. We sit down with every single family and we say, this is our program, this is what we do. And it's important that we do that because that's the only way that we're gonna grow the game, is from the ground up, educating them, showing them we care, and showing that we have a plan to get everyone better in the sport and make them feel like they're good at it from the start.
Hey, guys, keep going.
So we're gonna bring the panel up now, but before we do, so we had Dustin Toner, Joe Alden, and TJ Eaton. And I see Jeff in the back. Jeff, if you want to be on the panel, you feel free to come up.
I'll take it all in.
You taking it all? Okay, cool. But the way we have it set up now, and if y'all want to, I don't know if over there is the best spot, but to get everyone up to speed on kind of how we get everyone involved with Op 36, we have what we call Op 36 Bootcamp. It's a online training. And the reason we put it together is because we listen to the 60 facilities and say we need to be able to get everyone trained to run this program. And if someone leaves our facility, we need training in place to know that it will carry on. So that's online training. We set up your tech and then we help you plan, market, and launch it. Our whole team, that's what we're here for. I want to turn it over to TJ, Dustin, Joe. I'll start with Dustin. If you could just introduce yourself and just share some of your experiences with the program in the past year.
Yeah, my name is Dustin Toner. I moved to Cedar Rapids, Iowa just over 2 years ago. First head professional job was faced with a difficult challenge in the junior golf department. Now a guy I consider a mentor, another PGA professional in town is named Larry Gladson. For those of you that don't know Larry, he had this junior golfer, undersized runt, ended up in the British Open, Masters, his name's Zach Johnson. Pretty difficult competition when you're, you know, a young kid, you get your first job, don't know what to do. Luke Dona, who's my teaching professionals in the room, went to school at Campbell, Bowie's Creek, introduced me to Matt Ryan, and the program's amazing. 73 junior golfers. 2014, the year before we were there, the assistants taught about $5,000 annually. They did over $90,000 this year. Makes recruiting assistants another thing that you didn't touch quite yet, but it makes it a lot easier, especially if you're in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Parents are loving it. Kids are improving. We were over 900 strokes improved this year. Food and beverage revenue was up over 11%. Over the course of the whole season on Sundays, which is our Operation 36 matches, with the only change being Operation 36. So it speaks volumes to the whole ecosystem of the club, staff, parents, kids. It's a great program and highly recommended.
Joe Alden, head golf professional at Chapel Hill Country Club. So I won't bore you with the entire story, as Matt kind of touched on it, but I was at McGregor Downs for a couple years in North Carolina. And our director of instruction, Steve, was leaving. He was kind of an independent contractor. He worked, basically, he was just no salary or anything. They brought him on board a few years prior. He was kind of going towards retirement. So when he left, I'm faced with no budget, myself and two assistants, to run basically everything and still try to run a junior program and no extra money for anything as far as you know, for a junior golf instructor. And so trying to find a junior golf instructor, you know, with no money, you know, you're not going to find that needle in a haystack with another 55-year-old gentleman who's great with kids that wants a job for, you know, $8 an hour plus teaching revenue and not really, you know. So it was tough. And so Matt was Campbell University. My first assistant, Joe Ellen, was her husband was associate golf coach at Campbell, so that's how they kind of knew Matt and Ryan, and so they kind of got me in touch with them, say, hey, you know, they're doing this little thing, kind of junior golf thing, and so we brought them in, and I mean, it was a no-brainer. I mean, we went from, I think Matt's first semester was maybe 15 juniors to 70 in the fall. Made me look good, you know, made them a lot of money, it was a win-win for everybody. General manager loved it, loved it. And so when I had a great opportunity to go over to Chapel Hill a couple years later, made me look great at Chapel Hill, mostly running junior golf and a few other things. But the junior program had about probably 30 different juniors in it the year before I got there. And everything combined with the junior golf academy that I run with Operation 36 and some different junior camps and stuff, we had about 75 juniors participate in some way, shape, or form in my first year. So the general manager of Chapel Hill loved it, our director of golf loved it, and it was a great testament. I had a board member, had two of his sons, got up at our year-end awards dinner and was just so grateful and everything that they never had any sort of junior anything at the club. One other thing that I'll mention that Matt didn't mention, which is very important, was he had two people at McGregor Downs joined only because of this, because no one else had anything like it. And at Chapel Hill, we started running in the summer. So within that first 6 months, I had one person join at Chapel Hill. So that's, you know, initiation fees, dues, everything, joined only because of this. So that's another area that Matt didn't even touch on as far as facility revenue and everything.
My name is TJ Aiden. I'm the Director of Instruction at the Hawthorne's Golf and Country Club in Fishers, Indiana. I started my position in 2016. I inherited a junior golf program that was fairly small, and on my first day at work, my general manager said, we need to improve our junior golf program. I went to Campbell University. I've known Ryan and Matt for a long time. To me, this was the first thing that came to mind when I think of how to run a junior golf program. I think anybody that's familiar with coaching and making money the last few years, group coaching is the way to make the most money. So I went to the GM, tried to sell him on the idea. It took a lot of finagling, a lot of debate, discussion, dissent, but finally convinced him to do it. We started 2016 with four athletes, junior golfers in our program, and by summer we had 80. And then we also had 25 3 to 5 year olds, so that was very exciting. But so we went from 4 to 80. In 2015, we did $17,000 in junior golf revenue. This year, I believe we surpassed $70,000 in junior golf revenue. We had 7 social members join full-time golf, so we're about 330 golf members. We had 7 social members, families joined from social to golf. And it's been a home run at our facility. The membership loves it. The general manager, the owners, they love it. You know, we've created a culture at our facility of instruction. So one of the things that Operation 36 has done is it gets kids involved, they come, they take instruction. Families get involved, they start using the same verbiage and the same wording as the students, they get involved, they take instruction. So from an instruction standpoint, it's been phenomenal. It's funny, I've had the opportunity to coach 24 PGA Tour players, and I've been on Golf Channel, I've been in magazines, but I'm known around the club as the guy that runs that awesome junior golf program. So that's pretty cool. So it's been fantastic.
Well, I appreciate, Ryan and I appreciate y'all just sharing. Sometimes, you know, it's just nice to hear that it's working in other areas, and it's, again, thank you very much for being here. We appreciate everybody for taking the time out of your schedule to just listen to us. I mean, it's been 8 years of trial and error and a lot of failures and hardships along the way, but we feel like we have something that will help create golfers and grow the game. And again, the kind of the three steps behind that, Charlie Gross, if you can stand up. Charlie is our director of game growth. So he actually runs, and will be running next week, he runs demos on all of our new tech that will be launching in March. And kind of the three-step process. Charlie, what was the quickest we had anyone start?
We had someone, a director of golf in Alabama, went through the certification on Friday, held his parent. I don't need this, do I? Never hear that in a while. I do need it? Okay. We had a director of golf in Alabama. He got certified on a Friday, held his parent orientation on a Sunday, and held his first academy class that next Tuesday. So in 4 days, essentially, he was up and running.
And we just want to make you feel like with our organization that you have a team on your team. We know how hard it is and how short-staffed everybody can get, but you, whoever you put in charge, they have a support coach to reach out to. They have a network that's running the same program. And there's a lot of systems, tools, nothing that we want to, you know, we'll go into all that. If you'd like to learn more, just give Charlie your card and he'll shoot you a demo that you can see everything. But you feel like if you integrate the program, you feel like you have a team that's on your team to help you grow the game, create revenue, and we can help you create maybe even a new position at your facility that funds itself. Ryan, anything to add?
No, that was great. Thank you for your time. Just to end briefly, does anybody have any questions? Yes, sir, in the red.
What do you guys just evaluate how you integrated this either into or replacing the junior golf program? I think everyone here probably has a program, but did you use it to either replace the program, or did you build it into kind of combine and kind of elaborate on how you structured it?
So I'll start. So in 2015, we were doing everything as a facility before I got there. We were doing camps, we were doing junior league, we were doing clinics. Matt and I were sitting down talking about this just a moment ago. This has been a solution for everything. So this year, in fact, we've done away with all camps, we've done away with all clinics, we've even done away with PGA Junior League. That might be a bit of a sin to say at the PGA show, but
no need for it.
No need for it. This is it. We had parents that would come and say to us, hey, our child can only do one, they can only do Operation 36, they can only do PGA Junior League, which one is it? And for us, we were charging $175 for PGA Junior League with $75 going back to the PGA, and we charge $550 per semester for a child, and we did 80 in the summer, but we still do between 25 and 30 in the spring and fall. It was a no-brainer. There's no need for us to do anything else. And some might agree and some might disagree, that's fine, but we make a lot more money doing Operation 36. It's a no-brainer for us.
So when I got to Chapel Hill, they kind of had as I mentioned, there was only a few handful of juniors that would do anything, but they kind of wanted to keep kind of the norm, so I kind of kept all the same stuff and then added this into there. But this year, I'm still going to do a few spring clinics for the juniors late February and into March. So that'll kind of be for the parents that say, well, my junior doesn't have time for all this, so we'll do that, but hopefully, get it to where they have so much fun that they're like, wow, yeah, I really love golf. I really want to do golf more, to try to get them into this program. And then we did it during the summer last year, but with so many families traveling and going down to Wilmington to the beach and everything from being at Chapel Hill, that summer really was difficult. A lot of people were missing classes. And so I'm taking the second half of June, July, and first half of August off. So I was doing some summer camps and different things, and well, I'll use those two things to try to get juniors interested to move it into this. But we're not doing PGA Junior League or anything like that. It's when you're doing class once a week, supervised practice on Saturdays, match on Sundays, and then to try to fit in a PGA Junior League match and practice in there too. I mean, it's impossible because parents are still going to play basketball. The kids are still going to play basketball and lacrosse and all the other soccer and all the other sports. So it's a balancing act. They just don't have time for the two.
Not a whole lot to echo from, or I'd echo everything they say, not too much to add other than we have four layers of the program. Layer one is the weekly class. We might have had three kids do the class only, because all we did is we'd tell them, we'd say, does your son, daughter play soccer? Well, do they only go to practice, never play in a game? Oh, that makes sense. So then they signed up for the match on Sunday. So the first layer really didn't exist. That got more revenue for the club, second site visit, so on and so forth. The third level came with it came with supervised practice. So that's on Saturday. And they actually come, and we have two instructors out there, and they just run around. There's typically 12 a week that show up, and they actually ask us questions. Here's what I want to work on. In my match, I got in the sand trap. I couldn't get out. Can you show me how to do this? And then the fourth layer comes with privatized lessons. So it really does kind of create a niche market for any family. We're now taking the same program in the ladies this year. We no longer have a ladies nine-hole league. We have the Operation 36 league on Tuesdays. It's going to run at 8:30 in the morning. We're going to do another one at 5 o'clock at night for those that work. So it's been great.
Thank you, Dustin. Thank you, guys. Anybody else? Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah, Dustin kind of touched on my question. Have you ever brought this to adults?
Have you ever brought this to
adults? And it sounds like you have, but have any of the others successfully?
Do you want to hear from them again?
Yeah, please.
We've run ladies in Keith Hills. I'm happy to share that as well, but I'll let Dustin go first.
Our ladies came to us, the parents. They wanted to do it. And we had he was actually my member guest chairman, fun guy. he started taking the test with his kids. And he'd probably do it once or twice a week after work. And we're looking at possibly even expanding that into the men soon. But it's been wildly successful. Shop sales are improving with ladies, which is my probably biggest frustration, because they're actually getting, you know, 10 bucks into the pot every week to go out and play nine holes for 25 yards. So it's worked out really well.
The only thing I'll add on the ladies is it's extremely simple to teach. I had my intern from Campbell teach the class. He taught it very similar to the junior classes with the same curriculum. The ladies absolutely loved it, and they love the matches. The challenge we had at one of our facilities is pace of play got too fast. I don't know if you ever had that problem before, but pace of play was so fast it was running into the groups in front of them. So the ladies actually had to hit a tee ball, and then they would go to their yardage and then play in from there. So it was an absolute hit at Keith Hills. We ran a pilot program, and it was the parents who kind of forced our hand. We didn't want it to go that route. I wanted to just teach juniors, but the parents just kept coming and going, I want to do this, I want to do this, I want to do this.
And just to add to that, we spent the last 6 months, because of this, it was branded online as a junior program. We spent the last 6 months rebranding into family coaching program. And that's where we see us really fitting in. We're like, we're listening to the market. The market's telling us we should do this for ladies. We heard it 1,000 times, but everything was geared towards juniors. So the new software, the new branding on the mobile app, everything is geared towards family. So the pictures are kind of family in there versus just kids. And as we grow and continue to grow, you can use the Op36 name as much or as little as you like. That's what we always say. It's just kind of a framework or a back end to help you run it. And but if they do say, if you want help marketing, we're going to continue. We have a lot of, we're putting a lot of effort into rebranding, getting new videos of ladies, juniors, men on our website that explains the program, so that way it's easier for you to get people into it. Oh, this is, we use the Op36 framework, go to operation36.golf and watch all the videos, and that's how it's structured. It's supposed to be an educational-based website, so by the time they sit down with you for an orientation, you're literally just going, here's our tuition, here's our schedule, here's how you sign up, and then we have a web portal for them to go, and you get your own custom web portal, they sign up for your classes there, you can email your classes through it. Later this year, you'll be able to bill through that. I know that's not a huge thing for a lot of clubs, they can do that through their club management system, but that's one of our big initiatives. Is it is family coaching on there now. We're going to have a lot of videos of ladies, juniors, men doing it to help kind of back our professionals that are using it and make it easier to understand this year.
All right, we'll kind of close up. Matt and I will be here after, and Charlie as well, for any questions. Thank you to the panel. Thank you very much. Closing activity before you go, if you can turn the person next to you. Whoever has the longest pinky finger goes first, and you've got to share something that you learned today or something that made sense. And after that, then the other person goes, and that, you are welcome to go. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.